inshallah, today we have Sheikh Jamal Zarbozo giving a speech about Iman and who is a believer, what is Iman and who is a believer. And inshallah, I request all the brothers to stay silent during the lecture. I would like no comments during the lecture. No one can ask. Jazakumullah khair, and inshallah, now I'll turn it over to Sheikh Jamal.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، أشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، now I'm not in the mood to give a lecture. I assume you've heard that before, but I think this time it is not a physical ailment, but is more of a mental ailment that is affecting me now. And this is related to some things that have developed since I gave a session for the women yesterday. The session was a fairly simple discussion of some of the fiqh principles related to women, and in particular we discussed one issue in detail. That's all that we had time for. We discussed the issue of the woman who is menstruating or having postnatal bleeding, and touching the Quran, reciting the Quran or touching the Quran. And I spent over half an hour approximately, I guess, and he's discussing all of the evidences related to that point and coming to a conclusion. However, apparently some things have been spread about what I said, and some of them probably are any simple misunderstanding, and taking a statement beyond what I said. And some of them seem to be pure fabrication about what I said. So I would like to ask our brother here to state what he has heard, what has been conveyed to him about what I said in that lecture, so that I may comment. And then, if I'm in the mood to lecture, we will lecture. I want to see if I have a backup lecturer in the room, in case.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It's just been conveyed to me through several sources. Certain things, I don't know. One of them was that either this was an interpretation, or the Sheikh said this, that that women were deficient, and for that reason they were going to go to hellfire, and they were deficient in their minds, and for that reason they're going to go to hellfire. Other complaints which I've heard is that he did not, he left many things unclear, and about 90% of the women were upset with the lecture. And other things was that the questions or the issues that were so it left, and in people's actual, I've gone so far as to hear doubts in people's faith. This is about it. All I've heard up to now. Inshallah. So if you'd like to comment.
Yes. Some of you.
When? Okay, let me just state some things. I don't want this to be entirely of this nature, but alhamdulillah, there's at least two tapes I expect that exist of that lecture. And let me say, first of all, that the hadith, for example, talking about the deficiency of the woman with respect to al-aql, I did not even mention that hadith in the lecture. You will not find it mentioned at all. And in fact, in my notes, I had that hadith with a lengthy explanation of that hadith by Sheikh Abdulaziz bin Baz, in which he refutes, yani, the idea that this implies any shortcoming on the part of the woman. Yani, this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordained for them. And it does not mean that as individual, yani, some women could far exceed many men in many different aspects of life. But because of, due to lack of time, I didn't even bother, or I shouldn't say I didn't even bother, I didn't get around even to discussing that hadith. I didn't mention that hadith. And I don't believe even at any time in the lecture you will hear me saying anything about anyone being in the hellfire. And maybe Kamal was there. But I don't remember mentioning anything about any woman being in the hellfire whatsoever. So if anyone is spreading that kind of thing or conveying that kind of thing, what they're saying is not true. They should refrain from saying such. And if anyone somehow heard those words that were not said, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all. Secondly, the question, I guess the issue that bothered them the most was the question of attending college, and I guess, did we discuss work? We didn't discuss work here? Maybe in one question I just briefly touched upon work. I mean, you send 100 questions to the speaker, and then you get upset that he didn't answer every question in the detail that you want. And there's some things that a speaker should be able to assume on behalf of the audience. If you speak down to the audience and talk to them as if they know nothing, they'll get upset. And then if you assume that they know something and you don't say it, then they get upset again. And it's like the Islamic books, either they're put out in poor quality and people say, look at the poor quality of these books, or they put out in nice quality and then they have to charge a higher price, so they say, look at the higher price on these books, and you can't win. So, and with respect to college education, what I said, paraphrasing, and basically what I said, it is very similar to what I mentioned in the first lecture. I don't even remember what that lecture was about, but somehow I talked about this, the impediments to Islam in the West. I said that if a woman is studying, you know, just to get a piece of paper, then she should not do it. And if she's just studying, and just to get that piece of paper to say I have a bachelor's degree in prehistoric Colombian civilization, and there's no point to that piece of paper. And in order for the woman to get it, she has to go and mix with men and be out of her house a lot. Actually, you know, college, I don't recommend it even for the brothers if they don't have to. I'm sure all of you know what kind of fitna and what kind of things going to college can lead to. I was teaching in a university and I left it because of the kind of fitna that occurs there. So that is what I said. That if, and then they said, no, suppose her husband dies 15, 20 years, she needs that as security. And I said, well, this doesn't make much sense, because I can assure you, you know, if you have a bachelor's degree of 20 or 10 or 5, even 5, now even 3 years ago, it's not going to be worth much when you go into the marketplace. Obviously, if there's a case of necessity, a woman needs to study for some reason, or a woman is studying and the purpose and the goal of her study is something that the Islamic community needs or the Islamic community benefits from, then obviously there's nothing wrong with that kind of study, and I clearly do not even discuss that issue. Obviously, the sister is not supported by anyone, and she has a family, and she needs to work, and obviously she is allowed to work. Even, of course, that doesn't mean she goes out and takes any job that she can find, but she is obviously allowed to work under those circumstances. Now, I hope. see, we received a note here, and in the note it says that about women's deficiency in the hellfire, it was probably from Riyad Al-Ansari's lecture, but she says, I'm not sure. Well, it was from Riyad Al-Ansari. Well, I know we look alike, we sound alike, but the one with the louder voice is me, the one with the very quiet and polite voice is Riyad. So, and if you heard it in such a way that it was, you know, hurting your eardrums, that was probably me. If you heard it in a very nice way, that was Brother Riyad. So he said, you're going to the hellfire in a nice way. That was his lecture. And Brother Kamal is quick to point out that he did not say that. And I'm sure he did not say that. I know Brother Riyad well enough. So, that's the fitna of Austin of 1996, yesterday's program. I hope this clarifies some matter. And to be frank, maybe it's being unfair, but it is being frank, and as I've said before, I am more than happy to be frank. This kind of thing often or usually comes from the side of the sisters. For whatever reason, and this kind of problem usually comes from the side of the sisters, where things are completely misinterpreted, misunderstood, and spread incorrectly. So I must advise all of us, and including myself and the brothers here, but especially the sisters, that when it comes to passing on what someone said, make sure you pass on what he said or what she said, and don't add anything to it, don't add your interpretation to it, don't add any corollaries or lemmas or whatever that you can derive from that statement. Because there's a principle that the conclusion of a madhab is not a person's madhab. In other words, I may make statement A, and you may conclude statement B from that, but you cannot ascribe that conclusion to me. Because there might be some overriding principles that would lead me not to go from point A to point B. But in your mind, you're just assuming that, I said A, so therefore I must also go to point B. So all of us, inshallah, and this is one of our problems, and this is one of the impediments to practicing Islam, and this is one of the priorities of Dawah, and this is one of the situations related to assimilation and reclusiveness, that we are kind of combining everything into this last lecture. And we are not dealing with one another in a proper manner. We are willing to, we see this nationally, internationally, we're willing to misquote one another, we're willing to make conclusions or extend a person's statement when he in fact, or she in fact, never made such a statement. So, as I said, I hope this clarifies this matter. If I hurt anybody's feelings, I sincerely, of course, apologize for that. If anyone misunderstood what I said, I'm sorry about that. If I sound very harsh, that's my lecture voice. you can ask anyone who knows me, and if we're sitting at a table for dinner, I'm not going to be the person leading the conversation. I'll be eating my food and letting everybody else talk as much as they want. And so, but when you give a lecture and when you give a speech, you could give it in a monotonic way, you could give it in such a way that it's not going to affect the people whatsoever, but there's no purpose behind that. And also, when you give a lecture, you should be giving things which are from your heart. And when you speak from your heart, especially to a large audience, obviously there's going to be some emotion and so forth. Well, I don't know what more to say about that that issue. And I pray, inshallah, that whatever wrong, whatever mistakes and whatever evil has come out of that lecture, that inshallah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide us to a way that will put an end to that and bring our hearts together, inshallah. So now what shall we do about this lecture today? Because you know this, the problem is that this this issue, I mean, many brothers were drugged. That's the difference between having an English speaker as opposed to an Arab brother standing up here. You won't get those kinds of mistakes. many brothers were dragged into it, and to be frank, I've seen it in front of me. This has caused some kind of hardship between some of the brothers. And this is the way things happen. Not between myself and others, but I've seen it between two and others. And this is the one who's responsible for all of this hardship, the one who's responsible for the bad feelings that are in the hearts of some of the brothers now towards one another. All of this sin, all of this responsibility falls upon those people who, number one, were misconveying what I said, or adding something to what I said. Well, as I said, alhamdulillah, the tapes are available, and I'm sure that if you listen to the tapes, you will see that inshallah. Inshallah, I hope what I said was correct. Of course, if a woman is yelling at me, claiming that I'm kind of saying that Muslim women should be ignorant at home, doing nothing, and leave everything for the Jewish and Christian women, and obviously I might respond to that in not the most polite way, and I have the right to. I mean, if she's going to make a statement like that towards me, I have the right to respond. But I think I kept my cool during most of that time. But I think that's enough, inshallah. So now, alhamdulillah, I have another excuse for a poor quality lecture. And it first was the headache and the nausea, then just the headache, and now the mental fatigue and wear and tear that visiting Texas oftentimes brings to me. So inshallah, let us, I'm going to try to go through this, but frankly, my mind is not in the kind of a frame of mind that I'm really in the mood to make lecture right now, but I will inshallah do my best. The lecture topic is what is Iman and who is a believer? Someone has to be sitting here. I mean, you can't just leave a brother all by himself in front of the masses, especially after what has happened in the past day or two. This question of what is Iman, who is the believer, what is kufr or disbelief, and who is a disbeliever, and to be frank, these are some of the most important questions that anyone could ask. And in particular, they are some of the most important questions that a person should ask on behalf of his own welfare. And everyone should be concerned with the idea of whether or not he is a believer. If someone hasn't even reached that point, that he doesn't even ask himself whether or not he's a believer and what is faith and what does it really mean to be a believer, and this is already a very bad sign. And if you haven't even bothered ever to ask yourself, you know, what does it really mean to be a believer? Am I a believer? And if you're not even concerned enough about your deen, to ask yourself whether or not you're truly a believer, this is a very, very sad sign. And in the history of Islam, actually, as I said, because of the importance of this topic, this is one of the first topics that came up in the Muslim nation. And unfortunately, it was one of the first topics that led to division among the Muslims. And the reason, and we see it clearly in this case, and the reason it led to division is that some groups and they came up with their own concept of iman and kufr, and the concepts that they developed were not exactly correct according to the Quran and Sunnah. And especially on this issue, yani when you make mistakes on this issue about what is faith and what is unfaith, as some people call it, kufr, yani disbelief, I don't know what's a good word in English for that. And the ramifications of being mistaken on this point for yourself as an individual and for the nation or for the community as a whole are very grave. And especially any of the extremes. One extreme was to give a very narrow definition for iman, and it's to the point that if anyone commits a grave sin, and if anyone commits what is known as a kabira or a major sin, then he falls outside of the fold of Islam. He's no longer a Muslim. So this group starts declaring, you know, almost everybody non-Muslim. That extreme is very dangerous for the community as a whole because it caused division, a great deal of division. The other extreme is very dangerous for the community as a whole, but in particular for the individual, it is extremely dangerous. And that's the other extreme where virtually everybody becomes a mu'min. Everybody is a believer. And regardless of what you say or do, and it's to the point that some people, and again, and we can show from the Quran and Sunnah that and what they're saying is not correct, but some people said, look, if someone says La ilaha illallah, and if someone gives the testimony of faith, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, then he is a believer, and he will enter paradise regardless of anything that he has done. Others even went further than that and said, if someone knows or recognizes the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is a believer. So this concept, and there's a lot of things in my notes that I'm going to have to skip now. And this concept of what is iman and what is a true believer and what are the characteristics of the true believer, and these are very important concepts, because we know that faith or iman is the separating line between being in the hellfire forever and being in Jannah. I'll leave it at that. I will not go into further detail. No one come later and say, oh, you didn't go into further detail. I know that's part of the process of speaking. Sometimes you do that, maybe you explain it in more detail later. Notice how defensive I have become now all of a sudden. So some of the important questions related to iman is, what is true iman and who is a true believer, and what are the essential components of iman? And iman, let me start off by talking about what is the opposite of iman. Because some people, they instead of deriving their conclusions from the Quran and Sunnah, sometimes they kind of get stuck on the linguistic meaning of a term. And I'm sorry to say this, but we saw an example of this last night in one of the comments last night. And sometimes people get stuck on a linguistic meaning of a term, and they forget to look to see how the Quran and Sunnah has used that term. Because the Quran and Sunnah sometimes defines terms or gives terms different shades related to their linguistic meaning, but different shades to them. So for example, al-iman, or faith, the translation, if you wanted to if you wanted to define it with another Arabic word, is al-tasdiq. What's the meaning of al-tasdiq? Anas? You all named Anas, right? That's why that's why I said Anas. Look over there. Yeah. Okay, it means yani a sense or recognition or yani you could also say belief. All of these terms you could say form part of a tasdiq. The opposite of tasdiq is a takdeel, yani to deny something, to reject something, not to accept. Okay. So if you take the word iman and you say that linguistically it means tasdiq, yani that you assent to something, you accept something. We see here right away that yani the Quranic concept of what iman is about is not the same thing simply as believing in something in your heart and accepting it. This is not iman. Iman is not simply yani believing in something in your heart and accepting it as true or recognizing it as true. And iman is not the opposite of a takzeeb. But iman is the opposite of kufr. And a tasdeeq is the opposite of a takdeeb, but iman is the opposite of kufr. And kufr can take many forms. And if someone could recognize in his heart, for example, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exists, and knows very well that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exists, and knows that there's no one worthy of worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but that person refuses to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a kind of kufr. This is the kind of kufr yani, that was demonstrated or shown by a shaitan. He was asked to prostrate to Adam about istakbar. Yani, he refused. Do you think a shaitan doesn't know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exists? Shaitan knows that. Even the shaitan asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give him respite until the day of judgment. Even the shaitan knows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Rabb, is the only one worthy of worship, but the shaitan refused to submit. And because of this refusal to submit, yani this complete refusal to submit, this yani is one way of kufr. This is one way of showing that yani you have no iman whatsoever. So the first aspect that we see about iman is that when we talk about iman, we're not talking about it from a linguistic point of view. Iman linguistically has some meanings to it. One of them is a tasdiq and other related aspects. But when we talk about iman, what is faith? We're talking about faith or iman as described, as defined in the Quran or Sunnah. And if we study it, we'll see that there are three components to iman. The three components of iman, and is that for someone to have a correct and true iman, he must have all of these components. The first component is belief in the heart, or a tasdiq, yani bil qalb, yani belief in the heart. The second aspect is profession or statement, yani by the tongue. And the third aspect are the performance of the deeds, yani by the physical parts of the body. So iman, yani the belief, the acceptance is in the heart, and this is followed by the statement of faith, and it is joined with doing the acts, which are acts of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As I said, and we're going to go through many many things very, very quickly. But let me just talk a little bit about what we mean when we say belief in the heart. Or as some of the ulama have described it, is the statement of the heart. And the statement of the heart. This is also what is known as, sometimes known as Tawheed al-Ilm. And in this first part, is the recognition in the heart. that there is a creator, there is a Lord, and that Lord is the only one worthy of worship and so forth. And all of these aspects, inshallah, should be clear to everyone. However, belief in the heart also includes what the ulama call the actions of the heart. The actions or the deeds of the heart. And this is made up of many components, including commitment and voluntary submission and acceptance. Al-iltizam wal-inqiyad wa-tasleem. That, as we said in the case of shaitan, the heart just doesn't recognize this to be true. There's many things that you could recognize to be true. Smokers, many smokers recognize that smoking is bad for their health. But that's not, that's not the key to it. That's not what iman is all about. It is more than just the recognition of the truth, it is the acceptance of the truth and the submission to the truth. The willingness and the desire to follow and implement that truth. And included also in this category, and includes the love for this truth, and the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these are all essential components of iman as described by the earliest generation, from the time of the earliest generation of Muslims. Now you should realize that first, we said the belief in the heart has two components. The first component, the recognition and the acceptance that there's only one Lord, only one Creator, there's only one worthy of worship. This is something that comes natural to mankind. Mankind is born with a natural inclination to accept and understand this truth. To recognize this truth. To know that this is true. And only those, even historically, only those who have, the greatest disease in their hearts will outwardly come out and make statements like, no, there's no such thing as God, there's no such thing as a greater power, or whatever you want to call it. And human beings, instinctively, they know about the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That proposition is something very clear to them and easy for them to accept. But at the same time, although that proposition is clear to them, the ramifications of it and what it means for them in their lives, this is what they're not willing to accept. And you have to realize that one of the key points between dividing a believer from a disbeliever, why they're Muslims and why they're non-Muslims, those who are conveyed the truth and they reject it, is not the recognition of what is true, but it is the acceptance and the love for what that implies in one's life. Disbelievers don't like what this implies in their life. That they have to then submit, or they should then submit only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're not free to submit to whatever they want. They're not free to live their life in any way that they want. And that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in different places in the Quran, He has shown us that the key point, one of the key points between the believers and the disbelievers is not the understanding or the recognition of what is correct is correct. But as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بَلْ جَاءَهُمْ بِالْحَقِّ وَأَكْثَرُهُمْ لِلْحَقِّ كَارِهُونَ that it has come to them with the truth, but most of them are adverse or dislike the truth. Most of them dislike the truth. It's not that they can't recognize what is true. But they don't like the idea that now you're going to come to them and say, for example, that you have to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you must submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this means you can't go out every Friday, drinking and dancing and so forth. I was in a hotel one time. I don't know why these things keep coming to my mind. It's very bad. I was in a hotel one time, and a man and a woman passed by me. I guess boyfriend, girlfriend, or husband, wife, I don't know. And the man said to the woman, well, if you're not going to go out dancing with me tonight, then I'm going to have to go out drinking. Like, that's the two things. You have to do this or that. That's their life. But that's what they like. That's what they want. That's why they're following that way, because that's what they like. If you present them with Islam, most of them can recognize the truth of La ilaha illallah, and even the truth of Muhammad Rasulullah. But yani, they are not willing to submit to it. They don't want it in their life. They don't have any love for it. And this is one of the key aspects of being a believer. It is the love for the truth, the love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we say yani, belief in the heart includes this component of yani, having love for the truth, having the desire, the want to submit to it. And if you claim to be a believer, this is something that you better have in your heart. You better look to yourself and see, yani, do I really have the love? Do I have the desire? I want to go out and submit to the truth and submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is one of the key signs, yani, that you are a true believer. And this love in the heart, yani, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has shown us yani, in the Quran, that this love in the heart for iman is something and is special that is given to the believers, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put in their hearts and distinguishes them from the disbelievers. We quote the verse yani, in which says that most of the disbelievers and wrongdoers are adverse to the truth. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the believers, وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ حَبَّبَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْإِيمَانُ وَزَيَّنَهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ وَكَرَّهَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْكُفْرِ وَالْفُسُوقِ وَالْعِسْيَانِ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الرَّاشِدُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that Allah has endeared or has made beloved to you the faith and has beautified it in your hearts. These are the true believers. And it's the most beautiful thing in their hearts. If you want to know what is their concept of beauty, Brother Basim, he didn't mention it last time, but he's given a similar talk, and he's talking about what is our concept of beauty. And the most beautiful thing for a believer, in his heart, the most beautiful thing is iman. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has continued it, and he has made any disbelief and wickedness and disobedience hateful to you. This is another sign of the believer. Yani the kufr is something hated by him. Yani disbelief is something hated by him. Disbelief is an affront to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is an insult to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created all of mankind and blessed them with so many blessings, and then they refuse to submit to him, or they submit and give thanks to other things other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is something very much hated. If you love someone, if you love someone in this dunya, in this world, you love someone and you see other people harming that person. For example, if you love your wife and you see other people talking bad about your wife or cheating her or harming her, you feel it in your heart. And that your beloved is being hurt. What about when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is being insulted or disregarded, when the deen, the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is being fought against, opposed and insulted? And how could someone claim to have real iman in his heart when he's willing to accept all that, when he sees no reason why he should dislike kufr? We hear that from Muslims. You know, why should we dislike kufr and dislike disbelievers and so forth? Well, the reason should be because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put love of iman in our heart and has put hatred for these things in our heart. And that's as if we have the correct and the true iman. The second component that we mentioned is the profession and a statement by the tongue. And I will not go into that in detail, except and according to some of the scholars, they pointed out that and it is inconceivable. It is inconceivable that someone has the true iman in his heart and he loves that and he wants to submit to it and he's not willing to openly state, this is what I believe in and this is what I accept and this is what I stand for. So part of the true iman is this profession of the faith, the statement of the tongue, the statement of the shahada, to say, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. And finally, we have the third component, which is the acting upon that belief, yani the deeds that you perform. This is a component of iman. Okay, we don't have time to discuss the difference of opinion historically about whether it is a component of iman or not, but let us just stick with the majority opinion that can be proved from the Quran and Sunnah, and that is that yani the deeds that you perform, yani these are part of iman. They are part of iman itself. In fact, every good deed that you perform, or every good deed I should say, is considered part of iman. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam described that removing a harmful item from the road is a branch of iman. Every act of submission to Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala is a part of iman. So, and when you have the belief, when you have the belief in your heart, and when we say belief in the heart, it is the true, the correct belief in the heart, the correct iman in the sight of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala is the belief in your heart that drives you to act based on that belief. It is not some kind of dry, theoretical, academic discussion, let's prove, you know, that Allah exists and Allah is Lord, you know, QED and all that stuff. And it's not, that's not what it's about. But yani, iman is something that affects you. It affects your heart. And affects your person. And it makes you move and makes you act based on that iman. Based on that feeling in the heart. And this is yani, the true and the correct iman. There might be some questions related to that later, so I'll leave them with someone. Let me just quote one of the early Zuhad, or of the early ascetics. Is that right? No. You have two American brothers sitting up here showing you that if you want to learn English, stay in your country. You don't need to come here. Zuhad, we'll stick with Zuhad. His name was Sahal ibn Abdullah al-Tustari. He was one time asked, what is iman? And he answered, and it is statement, and qawl, it is action, amal, it is intention, and niyyah, and a sunnah, following the way of the sunnah. And he continued, he said, this is because if iman is only a statement without action, then it is disbelief. If it is a statement, and accompanied with action, but without the proper intention, and you're not doing it to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then it is hypocrisy in the Prophet. If it is statement, and action, and intention, but not following the way of the sunnah, then it is bid'ah. So you have to have all of these components, inshallah, for your iman. This part was very good, but yeah, this was very good. Yeah, we're skipping it, but it was very good. Yeah. Let's do it. Here's I want to get into a topic, and it's unfortunately it's already getting late because of. Many reasons that we kind of got into this late, but there is an important topic that is sometimes misunderstood, and so therefore inshallah I want to try to clarify this, and it is related to a verse in the Quran. This verse in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قالت الأعراب آمنا قل لم تؤمنوا ولكن قولوا أسلمنا ولما يدخل الإيمان في قلوبكم وَإِن تُطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ لَا يَلِتْكُمْ مِنْ أَعْمَالِكُمْ شَيْئًا إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. This verse from Surah Al-Hujurat, verse 14, which is many times misunderstood. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the Bedouins say, and these were a group of Bedouins that came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after accepting Islam. The Bedouins say, we believe. And So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, say to them, yani you believe not, but say we have submitted in Islam. For faith has not yet entered your hearts. But if you obey Allah and His Messenger, He will not decrease anything in reward for your deeds. Verily Allah is oft forgiving, most merciful. So this verse in the Quran, talking about these Bedouins who have just recently, yani, submitted, have just recently entered into Islam, and they are coming and they're saying, you know, we are believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, no. And you don't say that you are believers, but you have submitted. For Iman has not yet entered into your hearts. But if you obey Allah and His Messenger, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not decrease anything in reward for your deeds. These Bedouins, they were not hypocrites. Okay, some people understand from this verse that they were hypocrites. Okay. These Bedouins were not hypocrites. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly says that if you obey Allah and His Messenger, then your reward will not be decreased in any way whatsoever. So obviously a hypocrite by definition, he has no actual real iman in his heart. So his deeds are not worth anything. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about Muslims and saying to them that look, and you people and those of us who have converted to Islam, especially recently, or those of us who just grew up in a Muslim family and we have not really taken our deen seriously, we should pay attention to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in this verse. Basically Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, look, you don't have the right to call yourself believers. You're not at that level. You have just now submitted. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, alhamdulillah, says it in such a way, وَلَمَّا يَدْخُلِ الْإِيمَانُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ, and some of the Mufassirin point out, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showing them that Iman is going to come to them. And it is something, inshallah, they can look forward to. And in other words, there are some heights, some realms that they may get to in Islam and in Iman. But right now, how can you call yourself a believer and you've just now submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What this implies, and there's also another hadith in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that gives a very similar meaning, is that when we say Iman and we say a believer who is a believer, or we want to be a believer and so forth, we have to realize that there is a difference between a Muslim and a mu'min. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the difference. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has differentiated between the two. There is a difference between a Muslim and a mu'min. What's the difference between the two? What are we talking about here? And what we're talking about here is that there is a realm, okay? Or let's put in set theory. Yeah? There is a set, okay? And we can call this set Islam. Within that set, there is a smaller subset, and we can call that set Iman. There's also a further subset that we will not get into. I'll just mention it. And that's Ihsan. Don't ask me about that. I said I'm not getting into it. Right? So, what does this mean? And what are all the ramifications for it? We don't have time to go through all the details here, so let me just give it in a very cold-hearted fashion, as you people must be accustomed to by now. Right? And the outer circle of Islam and the inner circle of Iman, or the outer circle of Muslims and the inner circle of believers. For someone to be in that inner circle, for someone to be have the right to be called a believer uncategorically, and that this person is a believer, This means he is fulfilling all of the obligations of Iman. And to be in that category, to be called a believer, yani uncategorically, a believer, a mu'min, which these yani Bedouins had not yet met, it means you are fulfilling all of the obligations of Iman. So if you go to the verses in the Quran, that inshallah if we have time at the end, to describe the believers, inshallah I hope we get to them, it means the believer is the one who are meeting all of those qualifications. To take one example, the Prophet ﷺ said, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. Yani that not one of you is a believer until he loves for his brother what he loves for himself. Not one of you is a believer until he loves for his brother what he loves for himself. This statement of the Prophet ﷺ means that if anyone wants to claim, yani, to be a true believer, a complete believer, a real believer, he has to have this quality. And he has to have this quality that he loves for his brother what he loves for himself. If he does not have that quality, that characteristic, then yes, he's a believer in a general sense, but he is lacking in Iman. He is a believer who is lacking in Iman. And if we want to label, of course we don't do this, but if we wanted to label yani, people, the one who meets this characteristic and all the other characteristics, we call him a believer. The one who is within the fold of Islam, like the Bedouins, but has not reached this level, then we call him a Muslim, or we call him a believer who is lacking in Iman. Lacking in faith. He doesn't have the complete faith yet. So to be a true, complete, uncategorical believer means you are meeting all of the characteristics of being a believer, which inshallah we will discuss. What are the ramifications of this? What is the difference, and with respect to the hereafter, what is the difference between being in that outer circle and being in that inner circle? Well, the ramifications is that on the Day of Judgment, as we know, there's going to be three types of people. There are going to be the disbelievers, and those who rejected the truth or refused to follow the truth or denied the truth or whatever, and whatever form of kufr they have followed. These people will be in the hellfire forever. A second group of people are what we can call Muslims. They are the people who have Iman, they have faith, they have the minimum, what it means to be faith, to be a believer in the general sense, or in other words, to be Muslim. What will be their fate on the Day of Judgment? And if we are just at this level of being Muslim, we are from those people who are facing the possibility of punishment in the hellfire on the Day of Judgment. And if we're just from that outer circle of being Muslims, this means that we're not fulfilling the requirements of Iman. This means we are disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to some extent. This means perhaps we are committing some of the grave sins. So we are facing the possibility of being punished in the hellfire in the hereafter. But because of our Iman, we will be rescued from the hellfire and entered into Jannah. But we will be punished, for we may be punished first in the hellfire. And I think anyone familiar with what it means to be punished in the hellfire will do whatever he can, and if he has real belief in that,
and real certainty that this is going to happen. And if there is such a thing as the hellfire and the day of judgment and so forth. Really, man, he will do whatever he can to avoid it. But if he's lacking in iman, if his desires overcome his iman sometime, if doubts overcome his iman sometime, then he is in that outer level of Islam, and he may be punished in the hellfire on the day of judgment. If he's fulfilling the obligations of iman, then he's from that inner circle of believers, the mu'mineen, and he will enter into Jannah directly on the day of judgment without any punishment. And this is what these different components mean, what these different aspects. So let me, and just to be able to finish up, inshallah. And one thing before I want to get to some of the description of the believers, okay? Because maybe that will be the most beneficial aspect. But one of the points that I'd like to mention along the way is that if you go to the Quran and go to the Hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, you'll see that entering Jannah, entering Paradise, is always tied into being a believer. And you'll never find any verse in the Quran in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala joins and enters paradise with the concept of Islam by itself. Either there's a general promise to the believers, or there's the promise to those who have belief and do the good deeds, which is iman, what we're talking about, iman. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yani it says وَعْدَ اللَّهُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ, yani that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised the believing men and the believing women Jannah and so forth, yani it describes Jannah. You'll never find a verse like that in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says وَعْدَ اللَّهُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَالْمُسْلِمَاتِ. And always entering Jannah is tied into this component of really having iman. So as I said, let me, yani to be able to close the lecture. And the only good thing about yani starting late and having all those problems at the beginning is that inshallah there will be no time for questions after I'm done. Right? So let us go inshallah to the Quran, and we can also go to the Hadith, but yani just we have limited time. So let us go to some of the verses of the Quran in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the believers. And the purpose for this, again, it's not yani something yani just theoretical, and we can list the characteristics of the believers and so forth. But it is an opportunity for all of us to examine ourselves, to look yani to ourselves. Do we meet these characteristics or not? And to understand that if we don't meet them, what does that mean? And to understand that if we do meet them, alhamdulillah, what does that mean? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in one of the places in the Quran, Surah Al-Anfal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the believers. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins by saying إِنَّمَا يعني means that these are the only true believers. يعني إِنَّمَا how do you say this in English? Yeah, I know how to say it in Arabic, but that doesn't help much. This encompasses or يعني restricts the meaning or this term يعني saying that in other words, how are you going to translate إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ and if the only believers are those who do some such. Now here we're talking about iman, we're talking about that inner circle, yani the only true believers, the only ones who are deserving to be called believers, and in an uncategorical sense, and then these are the ones, inshallah, who will enter into Jannah without any punishment whatsoever in the hereafter. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرُوا اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ أُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ حَقًّا لهم درجات عند ربهم ومغفرة ورزق كريم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, yani the only true believers are those people who when they are yani reminded of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that their hearts shake, their hearts yani become fearful. That's the first characteristic. And nowadays, unfortunately, not nowadays, and always in the history of mankind. And sometimes if someone is doing something wrong and you remind him of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you remind him of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said about that wrong thing that he's doing, even sometimes the threat of punishment in the hellfire, it has no effect upon the person. And remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we sit after the salat, we make dhikr. And we can make dhikr in our hearts, nothing. And we are the ones who are coming to the mosque and claiming to be believers, and we can make dhikr and we can be reminded of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and nothing in our hearts. وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. And when the signs and when the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are recited unto them, their iman increases. Same kind of thing. And when we read the Quran, if you come to the Jum'ah and sit and watch the people read Surah Al-Kahf before Salat al-Jum'ah, and when we do that, when we read this, is there any effect on our hearts? Do we really feel like our iman is increasing as we read every verse? Our iman is getting stronger. وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَتْوَكَّلُونَ. And they put their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They put their trust in their Lord. They rely upon their Lord. And one of the aspects of relying upon their Lord is that they obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will provide for them. And they know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the provider. And I hate to go back to that discussion that took place yesterday, but basically the sister was almost implying, and now I'm probably doing the same thing that she or someone did, with respect to what I said. And she's arguing that a sister has to go out and get a degree and study because maybe her husband will die in 10 or 15 years and she'll be left without a degree or anything. Yani if you do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered you to do and you put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you are not the one who provides for yourself. If you go out and get a degree, you think now you have the ability to provide for yourself. How many unemployed PhDs are out there? And some PhDs in Boulder where I live, they are living in the streets. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who provides for us. And the believer knows that, and he puts his trust and reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. الَّذِينِ يُقِمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ, those who establish the salat, those who perform the salat in the correct manner, both outwardly and inwardly, coming to the mosque and praying in jama'ah as part of the iqamat al-salat. وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ, and they spend out of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon them. And a believer has many things that he spends his money on. Some of them are obligatory upon him. He has to support himself, he has to support his family, he has to support relatives if they are in need and so forth. And beyond that, he has many things that he spends on that are not obligatory upon him. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ حَقَّ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala began by saying إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ, and now says أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ حَقَّ. These are the true believers. These people. These are the true believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has emphasized it twice, that these and only these are the people who are deserving to be called believers. Those who meet these characteristics. These are the ones, inshallah, who will enter Jannah without any punishment whatsoever. These are the verses, that we should take and read them and ask ourselves, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describing us here? Can we honestly say to ourselves that this is a description of myself? that alhamdulillah, yani this is what I'm doing, this is what I feel. And we can then hope inshallah and look forward inshallah to entering into Jannah directly. And this is a serious matter, this is a serious question. This is one of the most important questions that we can ask and answer about ourselves. And before we talk about priorities of da'wah and so forth, as we talked about in the lecture on assimilation and reclusiveness, and Brother Riyad pointed out, and قُوْ أَنْفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِكُمْ نَارًا, and you have to save yourself first, and your family. And this is how you save yourself, and to see whether or not you are within the fold of Islam, and secondly, whether or not you are, inshallah, true believers. Well, in another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or other verses, well anyway, the beginning of Surah Al-Mu'minun, if you read the first 11 verses of Surah Al-Mu'minun, you find many of the descriptions of the believers. I will read one more verse in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing the believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ والمؤمنون والمؤمنات بعضهم أولياء بعض يأمرون بالمعروف وينهون عن المنكر ويقيمون الصلاة ويؤتون الزكاة ويطيعون الله ورسوله أولئك سيرحمهم الله إن الله عزيز حكيم. And the believing men and the believing women, they are the protectors one of another. They order what is right, and they establish what is right, and they eradicate what is evil. They establish the salat, they pay the zakat, they give the zakat, and they obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger. These are the ones that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have mercy on, when no one will enter Jannah except by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And is this how we behave towards one another? That we are each other's awliya? We are each other's any close friends and companions that we can rely on, that we can put any our hopes in, that when we see something wrong or we see something any a believer being hurt, we feel it in our hearts and we try to help our believer. And as I said, and these are just some of the verses, that if we want to be from those people, inshallah, on the Day of Judgment, they will enter Jannah without any punishment whatsoever. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be pleased with them. There's no need for them to be and cleansed with any form of punishment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with them and will show mercy upon them and will give them more than what he deserves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't send anyone to the hellfire except due to justice. And this is what they are deserving. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enters people into Jannah by His mercy. And if we think about Iman and what is Iman, and we can see that we're all and in different possible situations, we can realize that our Iman is not complete. If our Iman is not complete, that means in our heart we have some kind of nifaq, some kind of kufr. Because if the heart is not filled with Iman, then it is filled with its opposites. And you can have one heart, yani, which has Iman and has kufr in it. So we can realize that about ourselves and we can accept that. And if someone might accept that and say, okay, this is my situation, and maybe I'm going to the hellfire. But I don't believe any rational person any intelligent person, anyone with real belief, and would accept that kind of situation for himself whatsoever. Instead, yani, he should recognize his state, his situation, and have the desire and the love and the will and the intention to change his situation. And he may never reach that goal, but he has that love in his heart for Iman, and he has that desire, and he has that intention, and he's working towards that goal. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may look at him and forgive his sins and enter into Jannah, because and this is what he really wanted in his heart, and this is what he was striving for in his heart. He may have some weaknesses in this dunya and do some things which are wrong in this dunya, but and the love in his, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the love for Iman in his heart is the strongest thing that he has in his heart. Well, we might look at these characteristics of the believers and find, alhamdulillah, that we meet these characteristics. In that case, we should be very thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has blessed us and guided us to Iman and put the love of Iman in our hearts. And this should make us even stronger in our Iman and increase our Iman even further. I think on this point, and I will end the lecture. There's a number of different issues and related to this that are very important that I and recommend for my brothers and sisters and to think about, to study. And one of them is the ways of increasing our Iman and the things that inshallah will lead us to an increase in our Iman, and the ways and the means by which our Iman may be decreased and harmed. And inshallah, if we know these and understand them and apply the first category and remain away from the second category, and inshallah we will be increasing our Iman and getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, having Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pleased with us, and having the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter. Well, this is, and I think this is something that everyone should reflect upon, that pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this should be the things that are first and foremost in our hearts. The love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala above anything else. And if we are not yet at that level, then we should think of ourselves like those Bedouin Arabs who entered into Islam, that if we are sincere and we work towards that goal, inshallah, Iman will enter into our hearts, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be pleased with us on the day.
Jazakallah khairan. Inshallah, now, I don't know if there's any questions. It is time for Dhuhr. I think we'll pray first. Are you up for questions?
Frankly?
Frankly or Jamali?
Never up to questions.
Okay.
Just me up.
Okay, so we'll, inshallah, make adhan, and then anyone who needs to make wudu, please make wudu, and so we'll pray 5 minutes after adhan. 5-10 minutes after adhan, inshallah. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.